αυξάνεται. Είναι τα αποτελέσματα του φαρμάκου που χορηγήθηκε στον ασθενή για να γιατρευτεί από τα υπέρογκα ελλείμματά του. Η μελέτη των Ρόγκοφ και Ρέινχαρτ ότι υπάρχει ένα πολύ συγκεκριμένο όριο χρέους 90% του ΑΕΠ της χώρας που αν το ξεπεράσεις η ανάπτυξη πεθαίνει, είχε δώσει στην πολιτική και οικονομική ελίτ της Ευρώπης τα επιστημονικά καύσιμα που χρειαζόταν για να επιβάλλει τις πολιτικές λιτότητας σε όλη την Ήπειρο. Εντυπωσιασμένος από την ευρία αποδοχή της, ο Τόμας Χέρτον, υποψήφιος διδάκτορας στα οικονομικά στο Πανεπιστήμιο της Μασαχουσέτης, αποφασίζει να αναλάβει τη μελέτη των Ρόγκοφ και Ρέινχαρτ ως πτυχιακή εργασία.
Throughout the semester, I was trying to kind of rebuild their analysis basically from scratch and just based on the publicly available records and the part of the data that they had posted on the website. I was unable to. At the beginning, you know, everyone, including myself, thought that I was just making an error somewhere. After the semester was over and we were pretty certain that I hadn't made the mistake, I reached out to Professors Reinhardt and Rogoff and through email and, you know, just politely asking them for their data so I could take a look at it.
Η κυρία Ρέινχαρτ ήταν αρκετά ευγενική ώστε να στείλει στον Τόμας τα δεδομένα της έρευνας σε ένα υπολογιστικό φύλλο εργασίας Excel. Αποδείχθηκε ότι υπήρχε πρόβλημα.
Five countries didn't, you know, they didn't make it into the calculations, and that was really the first thing I noticed. And to be honest, I was tired, and I didn't really believe my eyes.
Obviously, the spreadsheet error came as an enormous shock. Through a simple mismanipulation of Excel, Reinhardt and Rogoff omitted five countries that begin with the letters A, B, C, and D from their analysis, the top of the alphabet.
You know, once we had their data too, we started running, you know, a battery of a whole host of different statistical tests on it, and we were just unable to find any threshold after which growth collapsed.
There is no threshold at 90%. There is no obvious danger zone for countries, and that in the middle of a global recession is not the right time to start engaging in austerity, because the real thing to worry about at that moment is GDP growth, not adjusting public debt for a non-threshold.
Greece is only one part of a larger continent-wide austerity program that has been stupidly and mistakenly imposed on Europe. But it has been. And what you know is that when you impose tight restraints on that debt and you don't eventually offer serious debt relief, the recession drags on forever. This is knowledge that we've had for a long, long time.
Little is poisonous and more is deadly. It's quite straightforward that if you implement hard austerity in the middle of an economic crisis, it's much likely to make the crisis worse. We had a very serious crisis in 2008, and we have made it much, much worse through the policies of austerity.
More and more people, even amongst those who installed the system, understands now that this is the wrong direction. This is late. After a lot of sacrifices made by citizens in Greece and in other countries, but better too late than never?
No, I would say, again, concentrate on the mistake made before the crisis. The state was functioning so poorly that at a certain moment, the society was spending 16% more than what it earned. This is the mistake. This is not acceptable. This should not be repeated. You have to prevent such a situation. When you are in that situation, the price to be paid is enormous. Enormous. You don't feel it, of course. When you are in the bubble, it's a nice bubble, you're very happy, you are spending 16% more. But after, you have to pay.
Η Τρόικα πιέζει επί τα
European elites seeking a realignment of the terms of the social contract in Europe that really has very little to do with either public debt or even the crisis of the crisis of 2008. When the Troika makes demands on a country like Portugal to rewrite its employment law, it's a very powerful intervention in the social contract.
This has been the perennial irony, is that Europe and North America were prescribing to the developing world policies that we ourselves had not implemented. And now what's happened really is that the shock doctrine tactics have come home. They've come, you know, they've come back to where they originated. The project is a liberation movement for capital. It's getting rid of everything that is standing in the way of making maximum profits. So who has got anything left to sell? Who's got anything left to cut? It's the welfare states of Europe. And Germany's next. Do they think they're immune? No, they're going after Germany after they finish with Southern Europe. They're going to go after France too. Nobody's immune from this.
Per la passione che il popolo italiano noi in generale abbiamo.
Well, out of the passion that Italians have for Greeks, and I know from my philosophical studies that this passion is grounded, but I will not speak at length. I would say simply that we live Plato's philosophy. since the very beginning. And with my husband, we visited Greece often with our family, my husband. So we are passionate about Greece, and it is really terrible for us to see that Greece is going through such trouble. Congratulations for your work. And the question is, going back to what we read about the corruption of several governments in power in Greece in the past, well, going back to that, the following was said in a program. What can you tell us about corruption? How come that the splendor of this country has been damaged so much that now it is a disgrace? So again, I would like to mention what I listened to in one program. They mentioned one example of the corruption of previous governments, and actually they provided a couple of examples. First of all, it was a transmission, it was a program, it's not my opinion that I'm conveying, but they reported two examples. They said that there are dozens of civil servants who theoretically are working, but actually do not go to work for weeks, if not months, or they are on a leave. And the second example is referring to a location in Greece, which I don't remember. It's a lake anyway, and then progressively it dried out, but there is still one office which is in charge of that lake, and there is staff in that office which sees to the lake, but actually there is no lake left. These are examples that, of course, are incredible. And yet I would like to reiterate that we are so sorry for Greece, because we love Greece. So I ask you whether the two examples that I mentioned are really true or not. And thank you again, and congratulations for your work.
Thank you. Thank you for your... Well, yes, these are the true things that you have said, and I can mention hundreds of other examples, let's say, that speak about the corruption in Greece. But let me tell you something. Corruption is actually an illness of all modern states, and I'm sure that you in Italy you have corruption. Don't mention Germany even. That Mr. Schäuble, for example, he is not allowed to speak on corruption because he is actually the protagonist of a corruption scandal in 2000. So, yes, there is corruption in Greece. We have to change that. Greece is not a paradise. It's a country with many, many problems, and especially I could say that the main problem, I mean, the mother of all problems is the mentality that I'm going to vote for someone that is going to make me this political favor, this favor, right? So it creates a relationship between the people and the politicians. This is what we call a clientistic state. Right, and I think that this is the main problem of Greece, and we have to break this mentality, because for generations, for decades, people were voting with this mentality: who is going to make this favor, not who has the better program, the vision, let's say, for the country. So you have this kind of mentality, and if we want to examine the roots of this mentality and, of course, the corruption, I think we have to go back to the establishment of the modern Greek state in the 19th century.
Yes, I'm here. I'm wondering why in this such a long time span you covered with your documentary, you did not stress strongly or more strongly eventually how the people react making like trying to find also positive solutions to the tragedy they were expecting, kind of making some cooperation among families and so on, or underline eventually if there are signals of let's say entrepreneurship or some kind of action to find out solution that were not just coming top down from governmental or political let's say leaders, but bottom up from society. So I'm wondering if it's
can you speak a little bit louder?
Louder?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it.
Should I repeat?
Yes, if you can.
Okay.
I can. Okay. You know, I think that you are asking something about the solidarity. I think.
Yeah, I'm wondering if it is, let's say, decision of your, let's say, is your own decision, or you think, or on the other side, it's a matter of that you didn't find, so it's a matter of reality, cooperation, solidarity, examples stronger than the one you present in the documentary, and together with this, a stronger entrepreneurship or economic trial to rise up some money. That a new, say, businesses, let's say, not waiting for the top-down action of government, but more, let's say, looking at the bottom-up solution that the Greek people, for sure, I hope, I mean, I feel, as much as I know, they also try to. So I'm asking if you think there are not enough, or you decide not to cover them for any reason. You are the author of the documentary, so you can have your own, of course. Reason to do this. Thanks.
Thank you for your question. I think that the solidarity example that I put in the film regarding, for example, the community clinic in Hellinikon is the strongest, by my humble opinion, example of solidarity that I have found. Why? Because it has to do with the health of the people. And speaking about cancer, let's say, it affects me personally because I have gone through this adventure. So when I heard this phrase that someone, a lady, took 10 days from her own treatment to give it to another patient, for me this is the ultimate example of solidarity, which embodies the meaning of self-sacrifice, which is thanks. Well, now there were other examples too, and I think that what we have gained out of this crisis is solidarity. Is there are two things actually. The first one is solidarity. And so the second one is what I call the political school that we are passing in a hard way. So speaking about solidarity, yes, there were other scenes too. In the first cut of the film, which is the first cut was 6 hours. So I think that it is not possible to watch 6 hours. This film was cut down to 2 hours. So you can imagine the amount of material that left without being inside the film.
I must tell you that I'm shocked about this, and I thank you for making it so clear the short distance that we might see, I mean, between a democratic situation or where we feel to be in a democratic situation and what is happening in Greece. really a short distance, and you just go down in this without perceiving almost things. And this is really shocking thing, and I thank you for making it so clear to my eyes. I really have no questions because I'm really, really with no words right now. But thank you. I would like that this film, I don't know if it's available, just to make other people see it, not just in this festival. I don't know if there is a sort of network where we can have the possibility of...
This film has been presented either theatrically or with TV broadcasts almost in every country of Europe, in the Arab world through Al Jazeera Arabic. It's going to be broadcasted worldwide from Al Jazeera English in a few days, and it's going to be presented in the United States, in Canada, in Australia, in some weeks. And its course is great, and its acceptance is very encouraging. It has been broadcasted, of course, and in Germany, and it was shown in theaters in Germany, and the reaction of what I call the active minority of the German citizens was amazingly good. We received many messages of solidarity, and people were saying that we are not the government of the country, we can understand what is happening, and we are seeing actually the black clouds on the horizon, because in Germany there are 2,005,000 people below the poverty line in Germany. In Finland, in Italy too, yes. And in Finland there are huge unemployment rates. In France there are budget cuts in the social welfare state, and that's why Le Pen is growing. The National Front of Le Pen is gaining ground all day by day. So I think that Greece is only one part of a continent-wise austerities program, and it has nothing to do only with Greece, actually. These policies have been implemented to Europe, and I think that it gave the opportunity to, let's say, the oligarchs, to use an old expression, to attack to the social contract. They gave this opportunity. The crisis was a perfect opportunity, because when someone goes to the Troika, goes to Portugal or in Greece and demands to rewrite the whole labor law from the beginning, this has nothing to do with public debt. This has nothing to do with deficits or in the crisis of 2008. So we have to wonder ourselves how we allow this to happen.
That's your learning. Thank you.
If I may.
Οι δύο είναι πράγματα που θα είχα προσθέσει στη δουλειά σου, και ένα μάλλον που για μένα ήταν καλύτερα να αφαιρεθεί. Το ένα πράγμα που θα είχα προσθέσει είναι το ζήτημα έτσι της Goldman Sachs, που έπαιξε ένα ρόλο πολύ σημαντικό στη κρίση και που είχε πάρα πολύ στενές σχέσεις με την κυβέρνηση του Καραμαλή. Και αυτό πιστεύω πως είναι κάτι πάρα πολύ σημαντικό ώστε να καταλάβει κανείς την ελληνική κρίση. Δεύτερο πράγμα είναι, εγώ βλέπω πως θεωρώ πως θα ήταν πολύ καλύτερα να αναλυθεί λίγο πιο βαθιά και μάλλον επιστημονικά το ζήτημα του δημόσιου κρέους. Δηλαδή, πολύ καλά που βάλατε σε αυτό το ντοκιμαντέρ
συγγνώμη που διακόπτω, αλλά μήπως θα πρέπει να τα πείτε στα ιταλικά. Γιατί
ναι, θα τα πω και στα ιταλικά, μισό λεπτό.
Γιατί υπάρχει μετάφραση ταυτόχρονη, γι' αυτό το λέω.
Okay, πολύ, ναι. Οπότε μόνο αυτό σας λέω. Θα είχα μιλήσει για παράδειγμα για τη Ιαπωνία, που έχει ένα δημόσιο χρέος που ξεπερνάει τα 200% του ΑΕΠ. Οκ, okay, σου δίκω είναι Ιταλιά. Δεν το έκανε το τρέο.
I have a couple of observations. There are two things I would like to add to the documentary. First of all, the creative finance by Goldman Sachs, an investment bank, which had major relations with Karamanlis government before Papandreou's government, and you did not mention that at all. And secondly, I would have preferred to... to have a better analysis of the way by which the public debt works. For instance, reference could have been made to Japan, where public debt is 200 times GDP, but Japan is not in the situation of Greece.
Notes. You are describing a different film, and you know it's obvious that. When I'm doing something, I had a very specific concept in my mind of what I want to be inside, and you know. So this is the answer. I mean, of course, when we are in front of any, let's say, human creation, we can say that I would do it differently, but this is not the case, you know. Of course, you would do it in a different way, but this film is me, so it's.
A quick question. Have you seen this other documentary that has won the European Movie Awards a few months ago?
Which is the title?
It's a German documentary. I don't remember the name of the director.
No.
Anyway, the statement of that film was the same as yours almost. They were saying the next one is France or Germany, someone. And they were saying there's two ways of regulating the debt, which is one according to international law and the other one according to Greek law in this case. So, have you heard of this? And if so, how can it be that they're arguing or discussing how to regulate the debt? I mean, I'm astonished. I'm no expert, but it seemed to me very, shock. It was a shock to me.
Well, with the second memorandum, we transferred all law under the English law. So we cannot...
You as the Greeks.
Yes. I mean, our politicians transferred all the debt under the English law. So there is no way right now to, let's say, legally or something, to write off the debt alone. Okay, to decide to wake up one day and decide, no, we are not going to pay this debt. Something that maybe... it would be possible under the Greek law. So, and when I posed this question to one of our prominent politicians, Mr. Vangelis Venizelos, he said to me, "Well, you have loaned someone 300 billion euros. Are you going to allow him to have the possibility to write off the debt by himself?" Well, and I asked him, you know, in which side is he. So can you understand the mentality?
Yeah, I see. Mm-hmm. So we would need to have a European law governing these cases, otherwise it's going to be a mess.
Yeah. And there is, you're right. But until now, this law is not in place.
Okay, thank you.
Altre domande?
Are there additional questions?
Vorrei...
The gentleman is speaking in a language which is not translated.
Πολύ σύντομη ερώτηση. Θέλω να σας ευχαριστήσω για το ντοκιμαντέρ. Εγώ είμαι δεύτερης γενιάς Έλληνας και ήμουνα εκείνες τις μέρες στην Αθήνα. Επομένως ήταν και πολύ συγκινητικό για μένα με τη φίλη μου που είναι εδώ, η Ιταλίδα. Αυτό καταρχάς. Σας ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Το ερώτημα είναι πολύ απλό. Έχετε μαζέψει απόψεις, έχετε συναντήσει Έλληνες κατά τη διάρκεια του ντοκιμαντέρ, ας πούμε. Τώρα, είναι πολύ, αφορά το σήμερα. Κατά τη γνώμη σας, οι Έλληνες, τι περιμένουν από τις διαπραγματεύσεις, σημερινές διαπραγματεύσεις, και είναι ή δεν είναι έτοιμοι για μια ρήξη, ή θέλουν οπωσδήποτε μια συμφωνία? Traduco la domanda. Che riguarda le...
I will now translate my question. My question was about the current negotiations between the government and the Troika in Brussels. I asked whether the director thinks that Greeks are ready to break any relationship, or do they want to reach an agreement?
For this question, I think that we have two indisputable facts here. The first one is that for the first time we are hearing the voice of a Greek government who is negotiating in the name of the Greek people, because with the previous governments we only hear the yes to everything. You have to cut pensions. Yes, you have to. They wanted the money desperately, so they were ready to sign whatever they were given to them, and in order to take the money. So this is the fact. The second fact is that this government has put a lot of water in its wine, comparing with its pre-election promises and pre-election rhetoric. So I think we have to examine, are they ready for confrontation until the end? This is a very good question. Do they want a confrontation? Do they want to break up, let's say, with the European Union, the Eurozone? I think that they are afraid. I think that they want a deal, but not a deal that they are going to kneel them, and you know, to they want a viable, as they say, and honest, as they say, deal. So, but I think that they, you know, they are afraid the breakup. It's what we are witnessing for months now. It's a poker game. It's a poker game full of bluffs, and in this, it's a tug of war. Let's say that someone has to step back, and otherwise the rope will break, and together with it, the financial stability of Greece. And also the stability of the Eurozone, on the other hand. So it's a very complicated game, full of and with a strong geopolitical fact aspect, which is in place.
I would like to ask whether the amount or
is no any danger for these banks, I think. The banks have protected themselves well enough, and on the other hand, now we own two states, two governments. So, and this is a, you know, a very sensitive part, because if you are not going to pay the debt, it's the same as don't pay the Italians or Slovenians, that they are, for example, the Slovenians are, you know, in a worse economic situation, let's say. So it's a sensitive issue, this one. But in the first place, we have to remember that all this adventure began because it was not in danger only Greece, but it was a system. And, you know, in 2010, the European taxpayers were bailing out, actually, the banks of Europe. And this is something that you don't hear very often.
Well, I think we could go on for days, but I think we really touched upon a number of issues which indeed are good food for thought for the future. Thank you very much, Yorgos, again. Thank you very much. Good night.
Grazie anche allo staff del.
We also would like to thank the staff of the Festival of Economics for making that possible. And thank you for coming. Good night.